But so glad that you came this morning to be a part of this very special morning, a morning to discuss the ideas of John Cobb and honor his legacy and life work. It's my great honor to introduce the person whose life and thought is our subject for our session today, John B. Cobb, Jr. Dr. Cobb was born February 9th, 1925, and that means he will be celebrating his 90th birthday in a few months. Yeah. As many of you know, John Cobb has been described as one of the most important North American theologians of the 20th century. And just this year, he was elected to the prestigious American Academy of Arts and Sciences. To his students and his colleagues, however, his importance extends far beyond the accolades and honors bestowed upon him. So much could be said about John's influence across so many disciplines. He's perhaps best known for being a leading scholar of process theology and philosophy, but his interests and writings span a wide range of issues and disciplines, including ecology, biology, social ethics, progressive politics, Christian theology and Wesleyan theology in particular, economics, postmodernism, feminist studies, agriculture, religious pluralism, Christology, science and religion, and even more than that. In recent years, Cobb's influence has mushroomed in China with more than 30 centers of process thought in that country alone. Cobb is the author of more than 50 books and hundreds of articles. And along with David Ray Griffin, Cobb co-founded the Center for Process Studies and continues as a co-director at the center along with Philip Clayton, Monica Coleman, Roland Faber, David Griffin, and Marjorie Suhaki. And by the way, one of my friends and colleagues said that the center has some books in the back if you might be interested in purchasing some of those or some new things there. As a point of personal privilege, I want to extend my appreciation to Dr. Cobb for his personal interest in and advocacy of me and so many others like me. There's much I hope to emulate in John Cobb, but I often tell others that I most want to emulate the kindness and generosity of spirit that you've shown to me repeatedly, John. In my mind, John Cobb's preeminence is as much about his character as it is about his incredible intellectual accomplishments. Given this, our session today is co-sponsored by four AAR groups. And as I mentioned these, if the chairs are here, I would like you to stand for a moment so we could know who you are. So if you're in that group and you want to talk to these folks, you can take some time at a break or at the end to do so. First of all, the Liberal Theologies group. I know that both of the chairs are here. Would you please stand? I especially want to express my appreciation to Dan McCannon because he was one of the major thrusts behind putting this whole thing together. Thanks, Dan. Also, the Religion and Ecology group. Are your chairs? There we go. Excellent, both of them. Thanks so much. And the Wesleyan Studies group. In the back is Ted. Excellent. And then the fourth group is the Open and Relational Theologies group. Now, we had a really difficult time selecting our presenters for this session because dozens and dozens of people came to mind as excellent candidates to include on this panel. We ended up settling on these presenters today, and I think it's a really fine group of panelists to honor John and speak about his influence. Our plan for this session is this. Each presenter gets 15 minutes. And I'm a real tough guy when it comes to the time. 15 minutes, because at the conclusion, we want to give John plenty of time to respond to these presentations, but also to respond to some of your questions and comments so that we can bring this conversation beyond this panel to the whole audience. Some of the groups have some sign-up sheets. If you want to be a part of an email list, my colleague Joe Bankard is going to start some for the open relational groups. I know there's a liberals theology sign-up list, and there may be some others circulating. Obviously, you don't have to sign up, but if you'd like to be a part of finding out information about future gatherings, please sign up as the list comes by. We will follow the order of the presenters listed in the AAR program, and to save time, I'm going to refrain from introducing each one. But to begin our discussion this morning, will you please join me in welcoming Philip Clayton?
John the Prophet, a tribute to John Cobb. From the Jewish biblical resource Chabad, the great prophet Jeremiah lived during the most crucial period of Judah's existence as a kingdom. He witnessed the destruction of Jerusalem and the Holy Temple after he had incessantly warned his people to mend their ways before it was too late. And when the catastrophe finally overwhelmed his people, he was the one who bitterly lamented Israel's terrible fate. At the same time, Jeremiah proved to be a true friend in need by helping his stricken people to bear the blow with courage and dignity, and by pointing out to them the path that would lead to restoration and redemption, close quote. When I came to Claremont over a decade ago, I already knew John Cobb as this Jeremiah of our generation. The words, you should look it up in Chabad, the words fit perfectly. But somehow I had pictured Jeremiah differently. I mean, he wouldn't quite be so short. I pictured a booming voice and a kind of ferocious look, which I'm not sure matches John. But the tradition does call Jeremiah the weeping prophet, the man who grieves the fate of a people that will not give up their selfish and headstrong ways. Note one final parallel. Jeremiah preached for 40 years, yet without seeing a real change of lifestyle in a stubborn, idolatrous people. Ladies and gentlemen, just over 40 years ago, John held his first conference on the environmental crisis. The title of the resulting book is as prophetic as any that John has published. Is it too late? Alternatives to catastrophe. The same question obviously rings even more loudly in our ears today. Imagine recognizing in 1971 that the planet is running out of time and asking that question, is it too late, 43 years ago. Asking that question was only one in three stages in John's evolving understanding of the global climate crisis, the crisis that AAR President Lori Zoloff has chosen as a theme for this year's annual meeting. The next stage, stage two, was John's recognition a few years ago that it actually now is too late. Many of us in the environmental movement had harbored the same suspicion, but we feared that to say it out loud would cause people to do less, thus hastening the climate disaster. I remember the exact day when John convinced me that we were wrong and it was time to start saying the truth. We were co-organizing a lecture series called Faith in the Future of the Planet, and John was the opening speaker. The room at CST was packed with people, and John stood up there and, in response to a question, calmly began to describe what it looks like as we hit the collapse, as we go over the waterfall. And in an almost dispassionate voice that was eerie, you could have heard a pin drop. He said, well, the Club of Rome was right. All those graphs that went up, written in 1972 to 2020, and then just as sharply they spiked and dropped down the other side. He said, now we can begin to picture what that is. the failure of food growing, the loss of the water aquifers so that millions of people no longer have access to water, the breakdown of social structures, the breakdown of social services in an area, the death not of millions, but of hundreds of millions of people. And I remember walking that evening and recognizing that's right. And that's what we now need to turn toward preparing for. In some ways, I think the second stage would be enough of a prophetic moment for a career. But John actually then moved to a third stage, the idea to begin creating the worldview for a planet after the global collapse. The conference in Claremont, I think you've received materials from the staff people, next June, 5-8, has the title, John's title, Seizing an Alternative Toward an Ecological Civilization. Do you see the three stages? Is it too late? Alternatives to global catastrophe. It is too late. And what worldview, what practices, what kinds of communities will serve as the foundation for us after that collapse has occurred? John's key theme, his litany now, his liturgy is communities of communities of communities. No Whiteheadian metaphysic could be more clearly summarized in those five words. Communities, which is the person, communities, which is our social group, our lifeline in a hostile planet that we have destroyed. And then more gradually, the rebuilding of regional and even global communities in a new kind of human civilization on this planet, an ecological civilization. Can you hold this for a second?
Sure.
I suggest that this is the identity and the narrative that we should most associate with John Cobb. The identity is that, as he puts it, of a radical intellectual and an activist. To be radical, John says, is to go to the root of a problem or issue. And to be an activist is to do something about it. As the data change, your understanding changes, and your activism changes as a result. I see four patterns in the way that John has done this through his career. I'll tell two closing stories, and I think I'll be out of time. Four patterns. Number one, John's insistence on going to the root of the matter. When many of us see part of the problem, his reflections lead him to see the problems on a global scale. Number two, John's prophetic challenge is not to a belief, a practice, a false theory. It's to the entire system that produces the injustice or the mistake in the first place. About 10 years ago, we were holding a series of conferences at Claremont about process philosophy and science, and I would criticize some particular theory, and John would say, no, it's modern science as a whole that's the problem. You know, if you're putting Band-Aids on a cadaver, that was not his word. You talk to John about a faulty educational practice, and John responds by challenging the entire framework of modern education, the organization of disciplines, the very structure of the university, the quest to be value-free. You mentioned a little problem in farming techniques today, and John wants to talk about overthrowing agribusiness. Yeah, you mentioned moving your funds to a credit union, and John says, yes, we need to destroy the banks. Number three, for a metaphysician, John is amazingly dedicated to empirical detail. Many of us criticize economic injustices, but with Herman Daly, John worked out an alternative economic framework. And with his son, Cliff Cobb, they wrote a metric for economic health not based on GDP. Or the position papers that John has prepared with Progressive Christians Uniting, position papers on social and economic issues that lie before us. Finally, fourthly, I want to emphasize John's willingness to learn. It's a kind of humility you find in very few successful academics in the academy. We've been talking in the last few days about going to University of Chicago, this bastion of liberal religion. John said his first roommate was a Marxist, but that's the only time he heard Marx mentioned. And then in the early 70s, he and Ignacio Cazuela were living in a commune in downtown Claremont. That was the 70s, right? It's probably worth $2 million now. And Ignacio said, well, I'm reading liberation theology. And John said, I don't know what that is. Tell me. And within weeks, his entire way of thinking about issues from before his doctoral work, through his doctoral work in the first 15, 20 years of his career, he threw out, replacing it with a socialist Marxist structure. When John indicates the strongest influences on him, he begins with Latin American liberation theology, feminist theology, and black theology, all liberationist theologies. I've never known a person honored as one of the great liberal theologians of our age being willing to set that aside to move to a deeper level of analysis, a socialist level of analysis. Let me tell two final stories and then grab this piece of paper. Two stories that most express my affection about John, but also his ability to put things together as nobody else does. The first is a Mary Daly story. You may remember that in a period of her career, Mary Daly asked men to sit in the back two rows of the auditorium and to remain silent, to have some sense of how women were silenced and their voices taken away for hundreds of years, thousands of years of human history. I remember a story, I was teaching with Mark C. Taylor at the time at Williams, and yeah, he said, I found this awful. I remember standing up and yelling at her from the back, trying to engage in the dialogue, and she wouldn't let me talk. I said, well, who was on the stage? He said, well, it was Mary Daly, and he mentioned some other leading feminist thinkers, and John Cobb. I think that's amazing. And then at the conference we had, John's doctoral students, many of whom, he has more doctoral students who are famous professors than most of us have ever had doctoral students. And so these professors were presenting, and there was this moment of sort of joy at the end, John, when you said, well, you know, I was friends with Wolfhard Pannenberg at the end, at the beginning of our careers, and Pannenberg was so brilliant, he could master all the fields and write about them on his own, so he didn't need to consult with anyone. I wasn't that smart. So he said, I have learned through my doctoral students, and we as a, you hear it, society, have brought about that understanding. Not me by myself as a solo actor. Again, challenging the omniscient male notion that's reflected in his metaphysics as well. Let me close, John, with three questions to you that I'd love to hear you answer. Number one, I presume it would not make you uncomfortable for me to speak of a prophetic strand in your writing. If you were to exhort your audience, this audience, not to lose the prophetic voice in their writings, how would you put it? What issues would you most highlight for us as being the most urgent ones on which we should speak up and speak out prophetically? Number two, it seemed like philosophy and theology did more work in your early writings, Christian Natural Theology, the Panelists book, and less so in recent years. Do you now believe that philosophy and theology are less helpful partners in making the prophetic call for change today? Finally, this four-part question imagines a continuum, and I'm wondering where you would locate yourself on it. One might think that Judaism and Christianity are uniquely suited to serve as the basis for a prophetic call to change. Do you think that? Or perhaps you would want to add, say, engaged Buddhism to this list. Are there others that you would add? Or, instead of singling out several religious traditions as the basis for this prophetic voice, do you think that all religions have some unique prophetic potential? Or, John, finally, have you now ceased to think of religions as uniquely prophetic? Reading Spiritual Bankruptcy in 2009, with its undercutting of the religious versus secular dichotomy, and your insistence on the importance of secularizing, I wonder whether you haven't left religion behind as a privileged category for prophetic proclamation. If you have, how would you then define prophetic today? I hope you find these interesting questions for discussion. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Philip. And also, would you please join me in welcoming Catherine Keller?
On the legacy of John B. Cobb, Jr., I thought I might write a poem of abject praise instead of replicating the prose of his modest, lucid ways. It would be a way of getting back at him for once suggesting that in another time I might have written epic poems rather than theology. But fellow scholars, have no fear, all rhyme stops here. However, to capture the legacy of John Cobb in whatever medium or genre is really not quite possible for three reasons. The first, the legacy is excessive, and we will excessively be repeating now Philip's point about excess. Multiplicity of books, of themes, of publics, of practices. Second, a legacy is like a will. It's finished, but this one is still very much in process. Yes, of course, the perpetual perishing into the immortality so flagrantly objectified in this room and in the world has bequeathed quite an excess already, but he isn't anywhere near quitting, as each graciously relentless call to help the June conference out makes all too clear. I'm glad he's still with us, really? The third problem, well, this is the thorniest. It is the character of his legacy to deflect from any focus on the legator. His legacy isn't about him. John Cobb has never been about John Cobb, at least not for the good Lord 36 years I have known him. There just really isn't an ego entity there. But there is certainly a person, altogether interpersonal, robust, recognizable, incarnate, responsively linked to its antecedents, indeed, writing a lovely book of reminiscences about them you can buy back there, and anticipating future adventures in this world and whichever. Indeed, if I had to come up with a visual portrait of him, I don't think it would be a photo or a painting. It would be a rendition of the fourth diagram on page 217 of Christ in a Pluralistic Age. You remember it, with all the capital B's, some with prime lowercase a's and uppercase o's on the left, and then all the lowercase versions in six rows on the right. It illustrates, he writes, the ideal consequence when empathy is added to perfect agape. Instead of inheriting from one serially ordered set of past experiences as my own, feeling other aspects as of the past as alien, I inherit from and partly conform to the feelings of others in a way that resembles my inheritance from and conformation to the succession of bees. Well, you can picture it. There he is. Of course, for my version of the portrait, I'd want to add some color and texture so that its abstraction would perhaps more resemble that of a Miro or a Kandinsky. And you do recall, of course, that in that book, which opens with the art historian Malraux, modern painting is illustrative. For the cosmic logos of creative transformation appears as a Christ that, to put it in an alien vocabulary, auto-deconstructs. It interrupts its own reification. It resists the morphing of image into idol. And we learn, in an unprecedented leap, to a full-bodied, indeed fully incarnate Christian pluralism, that Christ not only has lured him and us to non-representational art, but in a very specific way, to Buddhism as a corrective for the history of Christian egotism. And it was this Christology and those facets of it especially that lured me to go on in theology. Its planetary width of religio-cultural multiplicity spun around the vertical high-low axis of a cosmic and at the same time on the ground Jewishly Jesus Christ. And as Christ incarnates for him the Logos, the lure to cosmic unfolding, I add here that what Cobb calls Logos took the philosophical form for Socrates of his daimon, that is the Greek term translated as genius, and we have to do here with the Cobb genius. By way of its pluralistic Christomorphism, we may recognize in this serially personally ordered Cobb set a philosophically and prophetically theological Christian bodhisattva. That's philo pro theo bodhi Christian for short. But as this series is not about itself, let me shift to what actually matters to him. Let me crystallize it as his deployment of creative transformation against the major human forms of the fallacy of misplaced concreteness, which I think might be the Whiteheadian version of original sin. So rather than a wondrous garden cosmos where everything is in a certain sense entangled in everything else, we exiled ourselves to essentialism, to the world of clear-cut definite things with clear-cut definite relations. In other words, Eve's gift became Adam's commodity. So let me map seven registers of the Cobbsian maneuver. Seven short ones. As creative transformation is, for him, the cosmic Christ, it first of all undoes the Christology of misplaced concreteness. So rather than a metaphysically timeless substance stapled chalcedonically to a changing body, Christ now appears as the Logos finding incarnation in the very concrete life of the Nazarene, and still always as the creative lure incarnating everywhere in everything concrete to some degree, and with special social urgency for those now following Jesus. So, Christianity can no longer interpret itself as having a timeless essence. Christendom as the edifice of clear-cut definite dogmas, projecting the clear-cut definite deity over a clear-cut definite creation, is creatively transformed into an evolving historical process entangled with all the other great ways. We learned anti-essentialism from Cobb well before post-structuralism delivered a fresh form of it. Three. Many of us who were young feminists around John Cobb helped the essentialisms then, not just of patriarchy, but of our own identity politics come into feminist and womanist question, for we were already anti-essentialists. We did not simply identify the concrete complexity of our social processes with abstract sociological categories, even of clear-cut and definite gender or sex or race. This meant from the start radicalizing our feminism. And you know, I had asked Cobb, I think in 81, if I might do, please, Father, a chapter on feminism, and he replied that he was assuming that I would write a whole feminist dissertation. Number four. Whitehead's misplaced concreteness begins, however, with the simple location of bits of matter by modern science. So, Cobb hosted the evolution of process theology as integrating, well beyond mere dialogue, certain concrete insights of the most contradictory discourses of the West, science and religion, experiment and experience, his contribution to rethinking Darwin through animal learning and behavior transforms the conditions for all future Christian relations to evolutionary theory, as just one example. Number five. But the register of entanglement of Christian commitment in natural science that matters most to Cobb is that of the life of the earth. Through Cliff's influence, he had already written Is It Too Late? Yes, 40 years ago. Gruesomely prophetic, yes. And yes, his answer is different now. I don't think it's a simple yes. I think you have to come to Claremont in June to find out. And help it happen. Or he might start emailing you soon personally to make sure you're there. Just plan to come. The incarnational process of Cobb's logos urges us in work after work of his to the liberation of life itself from the fallacy of misplaced concreteness, which is to say, liberates it concretely from every deadening reification. And now, of course, above all, from the deadly captivity of global capital, before it is, in some absolute sense, too late. Six, the science, ethics, and religion of planetary trauma do not eclipse the wide range of Cobb's transdisciplinary transgressions. He took on the problem of specialism itself as, for us academics, the key manifestation of the fallacy of misplaced concreteness. And its sins are legion. By policing the borders of our own disciplines, we remain indeed a very well-disciplined legion, divided and conquered by the neo-imperial forces ruling the globe today with our collusion. And it is, for example, the hyper-specialization of the field of economics that has insulated it not just from ethics, but from any non-quantifiable commodity value whatsoever. And seven, because with that example, we do come to the appropriately last register, the lure of the common good against the fallacy of the misplaced concreteness that Cobb brilliantly analyzed as money. He called it economism, that version of the fallacy. The earth is subdivided into property, and all non-monetary values of community, of ecology, count as externalities. And in the painful originality of this analysis, Cobb lifted into visibility the intertwined lives of humans and non-humans living in the local collectives that actually constitute the living planet. Communities within communities within communities. Homo economicus is the hardened ego, abstracted, congealed, firmed up and erect, pulled out of the entangling relationality. You know, of course, some of us were long ago spelling fallacy with a PH. But unfortunately, for the common good, 1989, right? Followed by all those concretely readable, teachable sequels. This work has not, in these three decades, managed to work itself out of its job. You know, so it's rather recently that we hear ExxonMobil CEO Rex Tillerson proclaiming, "What good is it to save the planet if humanity suffers?" Right. It's nice he cares. And the TPP, which I, of course, first heard of from Cobb, is again being snuck forward, threatening to gut whatever regulations still restrain the carbon-spewing corporations, when it's now reduced to hoping that the Republicans will stop it just because it's Obama's. So that seventh point is indeed my last, but surely not his. Yes, I may say, I think, actually, altogether honestly, that I know of no other living personal series in or beyond the AAR, who has done more on this planet to teach the common good. And if we go his way, we are shifting from egocentrism to ecocentrism, and we do not misplace the concreteness of the common good itself. It does not then lock down into a homogenizing universal good whose particulars can be all too simply located by every CEO. Instead, we become together open, somehow sensitive to those barely possible possibilities calling for actualization, inviting our self-actualization in and as the uncommonly common good, as the commonwealth of God among us this very day, even here now at the AAR. And still, the challenge may seem impossible. But as ever, Cobb offers us his lucidity, like in the end of Process Perspectives 2, he recently wrote, "Perhaps a simple rule of thumb might be this: begin with the summary of the law, love God and neighbor. Do not believe anything that reduces this love or leads to action that fails to express it." Thank you. Thank John.
Thank you so much, Catherine. Next up, we have Gary Dorrien. Please greet Gary.
Thank you, Thomas. John Cobb is renowned for about 13 things, and I walked in here ready to go in one of three different directions, just depending on what Philip and Catherine did in front of me, assuming I had 20 minutes. But I've decided to give a legacy talk about the process school of liberal theology that he built. John Cobb is the chief builder, thinker, and leader of process theology. But process thought is based on the philosophy of Alfred North Whitehead and Charles Hartshorne, and there was a tradition of process theology at the University of Chicago long before John got there and earned his doctorate there. From the beginning, it was a high-flying enterprise with a complex, opaque, esoteric, and scholastic jargon, because Whitehead was a metaphysical philosopher who developed a technical vocabulary for his system. But for all its forbidding intellectualism, process thought, as developed by John Cobb and others sitting up here, is also practical, ethical, spiritual, beautiful, and at least implicitly postmodern. Otherwise, it would not be the strongest school of liberal theology today. When John began his intellectual career, the worldview issue was consuming for him. Surely, there was more to Christianity than just the worldview question, but none of it mattered if you had to make an exception for a supernatural God. To be a Christian, he had to accommodate the scientific worldview that had destroyed his faith as a master's student at Chicago. Fortunately for him, the Chicago School of Divinity had the same preoccupation, although he subsequently regretted that Chicago taught him very little about church history, historical theology, or really anything besides Chicago liberalism. He sailed through a doctoral program in 3 years, he wrote a dissertation on the role of metaphysics in theology, and he began his career at Candler School of Theology, which did not go well. John had the wrong theology to teach at Candler, so they just didn't even let him teach theology. In 1958, his career turned a corner at Claremont School of Theology, which was founded. Ernie Caldwell moved from Emory to the presidency of Claremont, and John came with him. Here, there were no Bartians. In fact, it surprised John that some of his colleagues didn't even go to church. In reaction, he surprised himself by becoming more of a church theologian. He wrote two books on trends in Protestant theology. He took aim at the personalist school, which at the time had more influence in theology than Whitehead, and at Henry Nelson Wyman, who had, shall we say, strayed too far from Whitehead. That was arguing with a movement spirit. John worked hard in those early books at representing others fairly, but he was committed to making a case for a theology with a Whiteheadian worldview. His major work, Christian Natural Theology, 1965, made the case like nothing else before it. At the time, the leading advocates of Whiteheadian theology were Bernie Loomer, Daniel Day Williams, Bernard Mayland, Schubert Ogden, and Norman Pittenger. But Loomer wrote very little. Williams spent most of his career writing one book that still hadn't appeared in 1965. Mayland rebelled against the scholastic tendency in process thought, and Ogden was just getting started. The only major systematic work of process theology at that time was Pittenger's The Word Incarnate, 1959, but it focused on Christology, and Pittenger was an outsider to the Whiteheadian circle, lacking any connection to Chicago. A Christian Natural Theology was a thoroughly scholastic work. Yet it brimmed with movement consciousness and a sense of the moment. Neo-Orthodoxy had become passé in theology, and theologians were debating the death of God. John believed the current crisis of faith offered an opportunity for process theism. Introducing Whitehead, he reached for the highest accolade. Quote, "I am persuaded that he ranks with Plato, Aristotle, and Kant as one of the greatest creative thinkers of all time," unquote. If Whitehead had been German, entire university departments would exist to expound his thought. As it was, the task of doing justice to Whitehead had fallen mostly to U.S. American theologians and philosophers. This project was strewn with Whitehead versus Hartshorne issues, on which the early Cobb sided mostly with Hartshorne. In 1969, John read a book that changed his life, The Population Bomb by Paul Ehrlich. The book struck him with almost unbearable force. If modern civilization was destroying the basis of sustainable life, traditional ways of doing theology were simply obsolete. Liberation theology drove home the same point in different ways. John noted that Black theology, Latin American liberation theology, and feminist theology all rejected disciplinary boundaries. Now, so did he. In his early career, he was a scholastic essentialist. Then he teetered for years between essentialism and cultural relativism. Then he opted for a relativistic theology of creative transformation. John was in stage two when he wrote Structure of Christian Existence in 1967. In that book, he argued that the essence of Christianity is a particular vision of reality or structure of existence. After his ecological conversion, he gave up the idea that Christianity has an essence, and thus he relinquished his concept of Whiteheadian theory as an answer to an essentialist question. Christianity has no essential nature aside from its transformative capacity. Progressive Christianity should stand for creative transformation, not merely consolation or renewal. John does not pretend to see it happening very much. He can be depressing about the state of everything. 25 years ago, he lamented that churches are no longer willing to think. 6 years later, he put it more bleakly, quote, "Our churches are sick. Without strong shared Christian convictions among their members, churches simply decline. That is what is happening now," unquote. More importantly, he said the trend lines for the planet are terribly grim. The global economy generates massive levels of debt, structural dependency, accelerated inequality, and unsustainable environmental destruction. To continue to expand the globally integrated economy without regard for the social and environmental ravages is to invite disaster. Quote, "I see present trends in the church and society as self-destructive. We are on a bulldozer heading for a cliff and overrunning all the obstacles to self-destruction. The few gestures I can make towards slowing down the bulldozer or diverting it in a different direction are all quickly pushed aside," unquote. but counter signs of hope, memory, renewal, and transformation are strewn throughout his work and the process school. When John converted to environmentalism in 1969, ecological theology did not exist in this country, apart from a few utterances by Joe Sittler and a few others. And for the entire 1970s, he had precious little company in it. In the 1980s, this picture changed dramatically as we got an explosion of eco-justice theologies, the World Council of Churches signed up for just sustainability and the integrity of creation, and the process school became a major contributor to environmental theology and eco-feminist theology. The Whiteheadian emphasis on relationality and anti-dualism has yielded numerous feminist theologies. In my volume 3 on liberal theology, I focused on Valerie Saving, Catherine Keller, Marjorie Sahaki, and Tendeka, but there were others scattered through that book, Nancy Howell, Rebecca Parker, Anna Case Winters, Susan Nelson, Pamela Dickey Young, Carol Johnston. It's sometimes claimed that process theology is too self-contained and metaphysical to reach beyond its Whiteheadian base. Theoretically, this argument has some plausibility, but empirically, it just does not hold up. When John co-founded the Buddhist Christian Dialogue Group here at AAR, his commitment to Whiteheadian thought was enabling for him. And this dialogue helped him rethink Whitehead versus Hartshorn issues. Catherine Keller's brilliant cross-dressing theology of becoming speaks the post-structuralist language of difference in ways that allow for Whiteheadian connective folds. David Griffin's writings on theology and process metaphysics are influential across the fields of theology and philosophy of religion. Rosemary Ruther was a leading feminist theologian long before anybody thought of her as a Whiteheadian, but the more ecological her thinking became, the more she relied on process metaphors and concepts. Langdon Gilkey, when he arrived at Chicago in the mid-1960s, was contemptuous of process theology, which he claimed was waning. But a decade later, when he wrote his book on Providence, he discovered that he couldn't pull it off without relying on Whitehead's dialectic of destiny and freedom, achieved actuality and future possibility. If you look at the vast array of theologians that I analyzed in Volume 3 on liberal theology, it's hard to find any that were not influenced or aided in some important way by process theology. We usually don't categorize S. Paul Schilling, Nels Fourie, James Luther Adams, James Gustafson, Peter Hodgson, Sally McVeigh, Gordon Kaufman, Bob Neville, Bill Dean, David Tracy, and Elizabeth Johnson as Whiteheadian theologians because they all deny it for important reasons. And yet they rely on process thought. They contend with it, and they appropriate it in their theologies. I am one of those who appropriate the process school without belonging to it. But that means I don't belong to a vital theological school, because there's only one in progressive theology today. American liberal theology, during its heyday, had three significant schools in addition to numerous offshoots and individual constructions. Today, we have one vital school and a profusion of individual constructions. Some of us gathered here are temperamentally averse to belonging to anything. But schools are the vehicles of progress and vitality in every field. If you don't have any schools of thought, you don't have much of a field. John Cobb, for all his relativism, his transgression of disciplinary lines, and his ecumenism, saw very clearly that building a movement was the best thing he could do for progressive Christianity and the common good. He and Griffin built something that rippled across the country and now has remarkable followings in China and South Korea. For a long time, the dominant wing of the process school was very scholastic. It worried about the referentiality of its claims, and you had to write that way if you wanted to publish in process studies. Today, the dominant wing does not worry so much about those things. Some process theologians are still very concerned about conceptual clarity, some just want to get Whitehead right, and many believe that Whitehead's concepts only matter if they work as generative and illuminating metaphors. This heterogeneity has enhanced process thought as a theological option. John Cobb, besides being a very dear friend to me, is my gold standard theologian because he works on multiple fronts for the flourishing of life. The only North American theologian with a similar level of accomplishment is Rosemary Ruther, and now both of them are at Pilgrim Place, plotting revolution among the liberal Christian retirees. Today, in theological education, we need to uphold the best of our traditions. We need to do it in ways that are global, multicultural, and interfaith. And we need to be engaged in solidarity movements for social justice and peace. We have a magnificent model for it in the life and work of John Cobb.
Thank you, Gary. It was fascinating, fascinating. Please join me in welcoming Michael Lodahl.
Good morning. Good morning. I first encountered the name John B. Cobb Jr. in a used bookstore in Richland, Washington. I was on home on spring break, 1976, from Northwest Nazarene College, where I was a psychology major with more than passing interests in philosophy and theology. As I browsed the religion section at the Bookworm, I saw this, and I actually do mean this very one, this blue paperback with the simple but intriguing title, God and the World. I had interest in both of those, so after a quick scan, I decided it was worth the risk of the 50 cents or so that paperbacks were priced at. Even the original price on this book is $2.95. Those were the good old days. So I bought the book. Now, it sat on my bricks and boards bookshelf during my senior year in college, unopened as far as I recall, and certainly unread. I think that during that year, I only even heard of process theology once. In Nazarene theologian Mildred Bangs Weinkoop's preface to her 1971 book, influenced a lot by Daniel Day Williams, by the way, a book entitled A Theology of Love, The Dynamic of Wesleyanism. In that book, Weinkoop offered this mildly approving description. Process theology makes a much needed correction to the dualisms of a former day. It is my considered opinion that though the metaphysical foundation of process thought is not the only solution to theological problems, its insights are inescapable in a biblical theology. The dynamic emphasis in relation to God, humanity, love, grace, nature, salvation, and interpersonal relations is crucial to the Christian faith. Well, in fact, reading Weinkoop's book during my senior year convinced me that perhaps I could stay with the Nazarenes. I'd had my doubts. And indeed, it was a significant factor in my decision to attend Nazarene Theological Seminary, where she was by that time teaching theology as she neared retirement. During that first fall semester in Kansas City, 1977, I was taking constructive theology from another theologian terribly important in my life and my education, a man named Rob Staples. In this course, we are required to do a healthy dose of outside reading from an extensive bibliography that Staples had compiled. Very early in the semester, probably during the first unit, I scanned the list of potential sources to read, and I saw Cobb, John B., God and the World. Hey, I have that book. I should read it. I did. And nothing would ever be the same. Now, Weinkoop's book undoubtedly had already begun to reorient me, to speak to me in deeply relational ways that simply seemed and felt right. But God and the World kind of blew me out of the water. Not until I read this book did I encounter such ideas as found in his chapter called Evil and the Power of God. And I quote, There is no reason to suppose that the world once came into being out of nothing, or that any precise goal or unalterable specific purpose has guided its development. I gotta tell you, I never read anything like that in a theology book. He goes on to say, the fact that theologians once thought this way is no reason to think so now. And I thought, who is this guy? I continue, we can meaningfully think of God as creator only when we combine the understanding of God's power as persuasion with the recognition implied by this understanding of power that God in every moment works with and upon the world that is given to God in that moment. Now, I immediately scrawled in the margin, given by what or by whom? Only later and gradually would I come to understand that the proper reply is essentially given by the world itself. A world that in every moment reflects the influence of God's earlier persuasions, but is never identical with what God has willed and called the world to be. Indeed, Cobb's next sentence was another mind blower for this first year Nazarene seminarian. If at any point we imagine God's willing something into being in a way that's not conditioned and constrained by what is already given, it must be wholly mysterious to us why God willed into being a universe so difficult to persuade into the achievement of high forms of order and significant intensities of value. Now, even as I waded through all this new language, I knew this guy was helping me to come to terms theologically with the evolutionary history of the universe and of our planet. 37 years later, I still find that one sentence to be powerful, compelling, and convincing. Now, I believe that part of the reason for the attraction I felt for the process vision of things lay in my Christian formation within the Wesleyan tradition. Others have explored the resonance between Wesley and Whitehead. Indeed, there's a whole book dedicated to that exploration. And I'm not ignoring the fact that many within the Wesleyan stream contest an overly cozy rendering of this relationship. I'm merely suggesting that there were ideas in God and the world that were not entirely foreign to at least some construals of Wesleyan teaching. In any case, John's own predilection regarding this question became evident with the 1995 publication of his book, Grace and Responsibility, A Wesleyan Theology for Today. Not surprisingly, in that book, John cited Wynkoop's Theology of Love, mentioning that he was in substantial agreement with her interpretation of John Wesley. We might also note that the second chapter of Grace and Responsibility is entitled God and the World. Here, the confluence of process and Wesleyan theology in John Cobb's thinking was beginning to surface. He quotes John Wesley's third in a series of sermons on the Sermon on the Mount. Here, Wesley preaches, God is in all things, and we are to see the Creator in the reflection of every creature. We should use and look upon nothing as separate from God, who pervades and actuates the whole created frame and is, in a true sense, the soul of the universe. Cobb is correct to comment, the immanence of God in all human beings is a major and emphatic theme of Wesley. That this immanence extends to the whole of creation is the most natural and consistent view possible. Wesley's God is the soul of the world, who pervades and actuates the whole of creation, and who enlivens, enlightens, and liberates all people, calling them to strive toward personal and social perfection and empowering their efforts. Now, Wesley clearly insisted also that God's presence, will, and empowerment do not guarantee any particular outcome, let alone an outcome desired by God. The presence of God, the Holy Spirit, calls and woos, but does not unilaterally force the accomplishing of God's will. For Wesley, this contingency was limited to human beings, and I suppose also to angelic agency. Cobb, I think, rightly expands Wesley's ideas about agency to include all events in the universe. In John Cobb's words, wherever there is a self-moving entity, God is present as the immediate source of that power of self-movement, moment by moment. But that power is exercised by the self-moving creature whose capacity for self-movement results from God's presence in it. Since contemporary physics shows that what once appeared as passive matter is in fact composed of energy events, Wesley's principle now applies to all of nature. Nowhere in the course of events does God function as sole cause. Here, God in the world, the book, and God in the world, the chapter, most clearly converge. So for Cobb, God is the one who calls, another chapter in God in the World, or in process lingo, God offers initial aims, and each moment of creaturely experience, each actual occasion, includes in its transitory becoming some measure of response to that evocative presence. The particular and peculiar energies that each creature in every moment contributes to the making of this world are received by God, respected by God, and indeed help God to create new possibilities for the world as it continues to become. In thinking of the world in this way, we find help for appreciating the vast number of experiments in living, in thriving, and of course, and we are threatened terribly in those experiments, as has been pointed out, in the evolutionary history that our world has included. These experiments, of course, continue into this very present moment. Further, to quote one of John's finest students, if God provides initial aims to every occasion whatsoever, then the very faithfulness of God requires that the divine harmony be fitted to a diversity of conditions. God is necessarily a co-creator of every moment of every creaturely existence. By implication, this must include also the diversity of cultures. No human culture is created solely by God, but equally no human culture is utterly devoid of God's alluring, evocative presence as initial aim. This means also that no cultural, artistic, or religious expression of the divine presence is unambiguous in either its origins or its effects. Real diversity is inevitable in a world such as this, and this must very obviously include the diversity of religious traditions in human history, a topic to which John, that is Cobb, of course, has devoted considerable and fruitful attention. Now we can close this loop by bringing it back to Wesley, for it is eminently arguable that this dynamic, interactive divine presence we have been describing is none other than what Wesley called prevenient grace. This is God's universal presence as soul of the world, but not an irresistible, overwhelmingly obvious presence, obviously. It is a subtle presence, a gentle calling in the midst of, and very often quite indistinguishable from, the creaturely realities surrounding and inflowing us in every moment. Nothing is distant from God, wrote Wesley, in whom we all live and move and have our being. This led Wesley toward a pluralism that he may not have been quite ready to consciously embrace. He could write of his conviction that Islam is a means by which people are taught of God all the essentials of true religion, and that, again in his words, it is not easy to pass any judgment concerning the faith of our modern Jews, admittedly an awkward way to put it. Instead, Wesley continued, it is not our part to pass sentence upon them, but to leave them to their own master. This is an intriguing phrase. Of course, their own master is for Wesley none other than the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Nevertheless, as the Jewish people's own master, God is addressed and obeyed. The experience of God is shaped, the perception of God framed by Jewish history, memory, and identity, which itself is, of course, shot through with delightful diversity. So I think that John Cobb has been a faithful Whiteheadian and Wesleyan, with his own wonderful creative transformations of each stream, and often by way of the streams intersecting. And he has so faithfully embodied the values of these traditions in his actual living, speaking, and comportment. Does not his life embody the values that he espouses? I don't think I'll ever forget one of my first actual encounters with him in person, seeing him in an AAR session many years ago, engaged in dialogue with his Buddhist friend Masao Abe. I was struck by the grace I perceived in both of them, but I was particularly moved by John B. Cobb Jr., his grace, wit, humility, intelligence, and Christian character of gentle love shining from his persona. John, I thank you for the way that your life shines. Now, a little earlier today, Catherine said that the rhyming stops here. I can only hope that she was not trying to send me some subliminal message, because I generally do like to try to write a limerick for occasions like this. But I have two. One is written a couple years ago, and just this morning over breakfast, I thought I really have to have something a little more fresh and a little more pertinent to the theme that I covered. But I want to start with the one from a couple years ago because I really like it. Christ in a Pluralistic Age was penned by a Methodist sage named Junior John Cobb. Could that B stand for Bob? Creativity crams every page. And now this morning, over breakfast, in this book called God and the world isn't something God hurled into existence from omnipotent distance. It's more like it's becoming unfurled. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a tough act to follow, but please welcome Marit Trelstad.
For today's panel, we were each asked to focus on a particular aspect of John Cobb's legacy, and mine focusing on the relation of his work to feminist and womanist theology. Dr. Cobb has had a direct influence on feminist process theology as an instigator at its very inception. But he's also had an indirect influence as a teacher and colleague to influential feminist and womanist theologians over the last 40 years, many of whom are in the room and some, ironically, in the back row. In conversation, Monica Coleman described the Claremont process tradition as tribal, in the sense that it's composed of real relationships of people, not just exchanges of ideas. And at the center of this web is Dr. Cobb. Encouraging and impelling the development of feminist theology, Dr. Cobb has been a demanding, creative lure for his students and a trustworthy conversation partner for feminist scholars. It is essential to note, however, that Dr. Cobb has also been transformed by feminist theology. It is a relationship of mutual transformation, and he has written about this in several of his works as one of his own major scholarly conversions. Indeed, an article of Cobb's in 1978 is entitled Feminist and Process Thought, a Two-Way Relationship. Let me begin with a story that illustrates the commitments that allowed him to become an open and dialogical transformation partner with feminist thought. As a master's student in Minnesota, I had read Cobb's Christ in a Pluralistic Age and found it very compelling. My professor warned me, however, that some of the faculty at my seminary would not consider John Cobb a Christian theologian. I was quite flummoxed by this, so I brought my question straight to the man himself. During an independent study with Dr. Cobb, I asked how he responded to scholars who said he did not write Christian theology. He stated quite openly that he would not disagree with them. He was sure that they were right according to their own definitions. And at this point, in a very typical fashion, he stated that he would, of course, consider himself a Christian theologian and a dedicated churchman. But other Christians would define the boundaries differently. He also clarified that he was rather uninterested in policing the boundaries of Christianity or the rules of the club, and he tried to pay attention to others' self-naming and their definitions. This story demonstrates, I think, some of the characteristics that have made John Cobb amenable to conversation with feminist theologians. First, he's consistently attentive to others' self-definition. And second, while rooted deeply in his Christian faith, he has not interested himself with defining orthodox thinking, allowing himself to be sincerely open to exploring historic definitions of Christianity as well as the possible future contours. He also seeks to understand definitions in their historic and relational context. And lastly, he's not aggressively self-protective about his own ideas. He wants to be convinced and persuaded, pushed, and he is open to challenge through experience and through good argument. John Cobb's direct influence and engagement with feminist theology began preposterously early. In 1973, Mary Daly published Beyond God the Father, which Cobb called a work of original genius. By 1977, only 4 years later, Cobb and Daly had dialogical chapters in the book John Cobb's Theology in Process. Now, Cobb's endorsement of Daly's work is not necessary for its validity, as I'm sure he would agree. I am rather impressed by his own alacrity to engage Daly at a time when I'm sure that many of his male colleagues were either quite intimidated or offended. While almost unbelievable, there are still Christian theologians who will not engage feminist theologians equally 40 years later. Indeed, as I was learning and writing about this, I struggled to put to words why this almost elicits tears of frustration. In my own denomination, there are still many volumes of theology and innumerable conference papers each year which do not contain a single reference to any women's scholarship. And here, 40 years ago, John Cobb was reaching out to publicly dialogue with Daly. It is sometimes possible for change to happen quickly and for a field to be responsive or even prophetic in relation to change if open and creative thinkers are at its helm. The first Process Feminist Theology Conference took place in 1978 at Harvard with a book of these papers published in 1981. Sheila Grave Devaney, who organized the conference and edited the subsequent volume, states in her introduction, "Dr. Cobb was the primary source of encouragement for this project. Without his support, it would never have taken place." Cobb was the only male theologian to present a paper at the 1978 conference, and he is the only male scholar represented in the volume. In his own essay, he describes how feminist thought echoes his own concern for symbols and language, but also says that it calls for a deep transformation of many of his theological assumptions. And I had written to him earlier to say it may be helpful to hear him describe today which of the deeper structural aspects of his theology he has found transformed by feminist theology, when feminist thought and process thought had so many clear affiliations and affinities. As a teacher, mentor, and colleague, Cobb has also had an indirect impact on shaping feminist scholarship in particular. In preparation for this panel, I procured the reflections of some of his feminist and womanist students and colleagues concerning the impact of his work upon their own theology or careers. I had suspected that Cobb's influence on feminist thought was primarily born by his legacy as a teacher, mentor, and colleague with feminist thinkers, and I believe my suspicions were correct based on their replies. His students and colleagues readily responded, and some themes emerged. First, Cobb accepted critique and the validity of women's scholars' voices without being paternalistic, dismissive, coddling, or taking credit for the genesis of their work. He was and is a goad to work, impelling his students and colleagues forward through good questions and clear thinking. Marjorie Suhaki wrote, quote, "John's empowerment of me was typical of his empowerment of all his students. I don't think he singled us out because we were women. It's just the kind of teacher he was and is. We women particularly benefited from it because in the 70s and also the 80s, we were on paths usually reserved for the male of the species." His treatment of students, unquote. His treatment of students was not preferential or paternal, and he had high expectations appropriate to doctoral work. Indeed, I vividly remember him handing me the newly published third volume of Pannenberg's Systematic Theology in German. He asked me to simply read it and summarize it for the next class period. As a first-year graduate student, I believe I looked a little taken aback. "You've had German?" he asked. I said, "Yes, but mostly in junior high and high school." "Well, you'll have to pass your German exams anyway," he said. And I went off to read. As many male and female colleagues and students of his know from their own experience, it is unusually difficult to turn down a request or challenge from John Cobb. Second, feminist scholars of religion offered examples of how Cobb has been a lure to creative avenues of thought. And importantly, as Helene Russell pointed out, he allowed them to not necessarily belong to a school, but actually develop in their own integral ways. Marjorie Suhaki described an early conversation when she was a student of Cobb's. She was concerned over Whitehead's consequent nature. She said his reply was, "Marjorie, I expect you to solve the problem of the consequent nature." She reports, "I looked at him in astonishment. I realized that John was quite serious, and she did solve it." "He actually meant it," she said. She continued, "Whitehead has a peculiar notion of God's aims calling us to be what we can be and empowering us to move in such directions, in and through the very calling. God calls us to become what we can be. These aims are really possible for us. They are not like some tantalizing carrot on a stick dangling ever out of reach." John's teaching was like that too, empowering us students to become that which was newly possible for us in and through his teaching. What we might not dare on our own, we could dare, for John empowered it and expected it. He had a way of turning students into colleagues. Catherine Keller, as she mentioned, also described how John encouraged her to write an entire dissertation being feminist rather than one single chapter. Rita Gross, who also has worked alongside Cobb as a colleague in Buddhist Christian Dialogue, commented that Cobb was instrumental in ensuring that women were a significant part of the group of all future meetings after an initial assembly of an all-male panel to which John Cobb invited Dr. Gross to join on the spot. Rita Brock wrote, quote, "He was the kind of advisor who gave me space to find my own voice without expecting me to clone myself on his ideas," and added, "It is the clarity, inclusivity, and coherence of his mind and ability to communicate that modeled for me what good teaching and theology are about. While I have my own way of doing theology," she writes, "I would be a much worse theologian and scholar were it not for having his example and help as a grad student to be a disciplined thinker, as well as a comprehensive, bold, and imaginative thinker who takes on social issues, all of which he is and does. I think he is a much more interesting and creative thinker than most of his students." Julie Nelson, one of the founding and leading feminist economists, also contributed comments to me. She stated, "John Cobb directly influenced my work as a feminist economist in at least two ways. One was that before I ever met him, his book with Herman Daly, For the Common Good, served as an example of an attempt to bring together concerns of economics, ethics, and sustainability. Since I work in a discipline, economics, where such resources are of inspiration are few and far between, this was important. Most importantly," she states, "that John Cobb's work was indirectly, and this is a quote, contributed to one of the foundational concepts of feminist economic analysis," unquote. Cobb's economic writings highlighted, quote, the analysis of relationality in economics, rather than the standard economic assumption of the individual person as the main economic agent. She spoke about the fact that relationality, ethics, care, and sustainability, all central to Cobb's work, were developed as foundations for the field in Nelson's co-edited volume, Beyond Economic Man, which was an early manifesto in feminist economics. Third, respondents commented on his teaching example and his commitment to social justice, the church and the common good, pressing to keep theology at its task of thinking. What does Cobb mean by thinking, which was mentioned earlier? Years ago, Dr. Cobb spoke at a Lutheran professor's breakfast where he said that Lutherans had perhaps retained their commitment to thinking better than Methodists. He had clarified that real thinking meant tying theology back to the world rather than being a self-indulgent abstract discipline. The Lutherans clapped happily. But Dr. Cobb said, Well, you may want to hold your applause, because I didn't say you were still thinking. It was just that you did it longer than we Methodists. He went on to say, to show us how we had allowed ourselves to become increasingly irrelevant, too compartmentalized, and specialized within the confinements of our discipline. This was tough news at a 7 a.m. breakfast. Building on this, Monica Coleman discussed Cobb's work in shaping the Claremont process tradition in such a way that process theology did not lose touch with the church. She talked about the false decision between serving the academy and serving the church, which many academics face, where Cobb has always kept commitments to both. And this was one of the reasons why process and process philosophy and theology appealed to her. It also took the elitist edge off of process thought, which is repellent to several of Coleman's colleagues in Black and womanist thought. In terms of Cobb's other influences, Catherine Keller had mused, it is not clear that there's any eco-theology or eco-feminist theology that is not indirectly and sometimes irritatably and hiddenly been influenced by Cobb's formation of process theology as already asking the question, is it too late? Indeed, it's fair to say that John Cobb has consistently been a decade ahead of most other scholars in terms of interreligious dialogue, eco-theology, economics, and even feminist theology. His current publications continue to seek tools for sustainability or realistically survival on our planet. He has emphasized the importance of historical consciousness as a resource for the present and future. Also, he has proposed that different religious traditions or ways translate their core beliefs and aims of each of their traditions into secular terms, such that these secular grounds may serve as the meeting places for world religions to work for the commonwealth of all creation. This secularization of religion consists of an absolutely new manner of conceiving interreligious dialogue as well as eco-theology. And if Cobb's pattern of theological leadership continues, I suspect that we all may be talking in terms of secularizing religious traditions in a decade. In closing, I am not really into hero or heroine worship. It is not a feminist value. Also, academic glad-handing is hardly a goal in which Cobb is interested. He exudes a sense of we're on to something very helpful for serious concerns, and this is why it is so difficult to say no to him. He believes the world actually needs us as academics to think on the religious level of our being and to address social and ecological crises, and his legacy should keep our feet to the fire. In his legacy, I would invoke us with a list of tasks, which is also kind of common for you, so, to be nimble and creative in our scholarship, to constructively shape the future, to deeply analyze foundational ideas, to be open to critique and transformation, to know history for the sake of the future. Don't forget the churches and believers. And think, applying the best rigorous theology for the liberation of all life. As an act of embodiment, Dr. Cobb, may I ask you to stand? And of women scholars in the room, if you feel that you have been influenced by Dr. Cobb's legacy directly, indirectly, or as a, in generations and reception, would you please stand? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Marit. And our last presenter this morning before Dr. Cobb gives a response is Jay McDaniel. Will you please welcome Jay?
I wish we were in China. And I wish I could ask the same question. I wish I could say, if you have been influenced by John Cobb, would you please stand? And many people would stand, and then I would ask, do you know he's a Christian theologian? And they might say, what does that mean? Seriously. I do think we are in the presence of the most influential Christian theologian in China today, who is not known as a Christian theologian. He's known as a constructive postmodern thinker who has vision and who consults with the government, but also consults with ordinary people. He's non-elitist. He's a sage. He has good ideas. Sometimes he talks about this person named Whitehead, sometimes he doesn't. But he has China on its side, and we are grateful. He was there a month ago, 89 years old, conferences consulting on sustainable agriculture in China. So I want to begin by saying when I was asked to be on the panel, I wanted to share sides of John that might not be as readily known among many of us, but which are really, really important. I got to read his theological reminiscences in preparation for this panel. And here's a sentence in the chapter on China. He talks about meeting some friends from China in Claremont and them asking him to be involved in things like that. And he said, "Indeed, I consider myself astonishingly fortunate. Until this development actually occurred, I would never have dreamed of anything of the sort." And then he writes, "For the first time in my life, I feel that I have the opportunity of possibly having some effect on the actual course of history." Now, this is the John Cobb that we know, and he has had such an effect on us that, I mean, what do you mean? We're history. In the best sense of the word. But we know what you meant. We know what you meant. And that's his humility. That's his humility. So the first thing I would simply like to say is, truth be told, he is having a marked effect in China today. And that's a very, very interesting thing. Now, I have three questions. Who is John now? What achievements have not yet been identified by our panel? And what are the leading edges of his thought today? I don't know the answer to the third, but I'll try anyway. We'll see. If you read this book, which tells the story of his theological career, it's very personal. You will learn about the person. You will learn about his family. You will learn about his upbringing. You will learn about his disappointments. You will learn about his sense of failure. It's not all one great story. You'll also learn about how his mind was working and what he was thinking and what challenged him. And you may end up wondering, as I did, I wonder where he ends up with regard to faith. Where does he end up with regard to his own Christian faith? In the last two chapters, last three chapters, are very interesting. One is called God, and one is called Jesus. And when you read this, you think, I think John Cobb kind of likes God. So I'll read you a paragraph. Many Christians in our society who grew up in devout homes and chose a professional career in the church have found in their old age that they have moved a long way from where they began. Years of study and reflection have undercut much of what they believed as children. Some have come to find almost any idea of God incredible or offensive. For some, Jesus has become one good and wise man among others. Some rejoice in their liberation. Some are pained by their disillusionments. So he's talking about his generation. And then here's the next paragraph. My situation is different. I rejoice that in many ways my childhood faith, while transformed, is not denied or watered down. I reaffirm the trajectory in which it set my life. I believed then that God is love. I believe that now. I found God then the great companion who understands. That is how I find God now. I look to God then to direct my life. I look to God now to direct my life. I thought then that the supreme calling is to love God with all that I am. I think now this is the supreme calling. Sounds pretty traditional to me. He speaks of himself as a biblical theist throughout the book. And if anyone thinks that there's a tension between process theology and biblical theism, I don't think John does. I think they go together. I'd say a word also about what he says about Jesus. He says that he does have a Jesus-centered view of history. Increasingly, I think Jesus has come to play, maybe all the time, John, but a very important role in your mind as you think about the course of affairs. So where is he now? He's somebody that feels those ways. Now, have any achievements not been identified, and not many, but I could think of two. One of the leading process theologians today is Jewish. It's Rabbi Bradley Artson. He's at Ziegler School of Rabbinic Studies. And if you ask Rabbi Artson, Brad, what's your community? He'll say, I can put it in two ways. He'll say, I can say that I'm Jewish and also a process theologian. Or he says, or I can say, I'm a member of the process community and also Jewish. And Brad thinks of the process community as kind of an entity. It's a reality. And he's actually quite grateful that he can be in that community, even as, of course, he's also in his Jewish community. And he says, I can have conversations, shared values, shared attitudes, shared feelings that I cannot have in my local community. Now, Brad's living and dying Jewish, no question about it. But it does occur to me that John has been fairly instrumental in helping bring forth what I would call the international process community. It doesn't have to be called that, but it can be called that. And it really is international. It's not just North American. It's not just European. It's not just Christian. A lot of people that are spiritual but not religious. A lot of people that belong to different religious communions. A lot of people, some people that aren't especially interested in religion but interested in the well-being of life. And I want to thank you for, even as you're a Christian theologian and always will be, helping bring about a kind of community that I think is really important and offers some hope for the world. The other thing I want to, I think people have talked about this, but I also want to say a word about your teaching model. There are a lot of students in here of yours, and I don't know if any of you had an oral exam with Dr. Cobb, but I did. It scared me to death. And you'd go, you'd sit outside his office, and people would come out, and their eyes would look kind of funny. What happened? Well, what did he say? What did he say? And they said, he just asked you a question. Was it a kind of empirical question, a technical question on Whitehead? No, it wasn't exactly like that. It was a question which, as soon as he asked it, would take your mind, you would kind of grow 15 years in your thinking just by the question. Because he would sense the question that you were on your way to asking and had not yet asked. And he would help articulate that question. And your mind would go spinning and you would go further. I think of that method of teaching. He was also a very good listener. He would have to hear you first to hear the question. He was a good listener. And his method, I think, of teaching was, I would call it propositive. Not dogmatic. Not this is the answer, not this is how you think, but here's food for thought, here's a lure for feeling, here's a proposition, try it out. Now, the questions, the leading edge of John's thinking today, actually, I don't know, but I do know that in reading this, John, I had three questions, and I can say them very quickly. The first concerns your distinction between the stale secularism of modernity and what you might call the healthy secularizing of historical Christianity and other religions. And in the context of talking about that, you talk about the sacred. And in this particular book, you don't have especially nice things to say about the sacred. It's a sense of the numinous, but you know, it has its place in life. But I get the feeling that you picture the better future for Christianity as having moved beyond a kind of fixation, at least, with the sacred thus understood. You also speak of the profanization of God, learning to think of God in more profane ways, less sacred ways. I'm not sure I can go there. I'm not sure. But what I wondered is, you know how David Griffin talks about the re-enchantment of the world and learning to look at our cosmos, our universe, as filled with subjectivity through and through, such that when we're in it and when we're aware of it, other people, plants, hills, rivers, we have a sense of wonder, a sense of awe. And it's related to a sense of life everywhere. And that might even include life in God. And so I was wondering if by chance you could talk about a new kind of sacred that's connected with amazement, awe, respect, care for the community of all life. That's question one. Question two about China. One thing I so admire about John, it would be easy, actually it wouldn't be easy to go to China, but we could pretend it would be easy to go to China and be kind of Christian evangelical, have a kind of hidden agenda, great to work with you, but by the way, would you consider? I don't think that's really part of what you've been about. I think John very quickly decided the best thing for China was to reclaim its own traditions and not to be, not to have forced upon it an alien perspective. And yet you do say in your book that there's a part of you that thinks that China would really benefit from a dialogue with biblical theism. And I'm just wondering if you might sometime want to spell out what that would look like or write about that or whatever. That's the second. Here's the third. I teach at a liberal arts college, and at the liberal arts college, we love to talk about interdisciplinarity. Interdisciplinarity is a good, good thing. Well, whenever we do, I get a little nervous because my mentor over here, I heard him once say, I'm not for interdisciplinarity, I'm for anti-disciplinarity. You know, that doesn't sell well. But the truth of the matter is there's been a side of you that has been so critical, in I think a good way, of disciplinary fragmentation, disciplinary isolation, compartmentalized thinking, silo thinking. I think the third question I have is because we're here now, is what would this mean for the American Academy of Religion? What would this mean for those of us in this room who make our living by gaining credentials in something called disciplines and trumpet those? And so what would it look like for the American Academy of Religion and maybe the SBL to hear the call to anti-disciplinarity for the sake of life? Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jay. And now we are ready for John. Those of you who came in late, John's going to respond to our panelists, and then we're going to have a conversation. So if you have some questions, be ready for those. And when we conclude, we'll go to that.
How much time do I have to respond?
How much time does he have? What am I supposed to say to that? Come on up and go for it.
Okay. Thank you. Well, I
have... How about we go to 11:15?
11:15, okay. My
In the final chapter of my book, I talk about looking forward to the next adventure, but I believe I'm already having it now, so I don't need to be in a hurry to go. But thank you. This is a wonderful to live long enough to have this kind of exaggeration. But truly, it is a joy. There are so many questions that have been asked, and one of which, if you know me, could easily provoke a 30-minute speech that I asked how much time with real interest. I'll start with the very last question. I think it is an interesting question. What if all of a sudden people paid attention to what I said and tried to do something? The result would be, of course, utter chaos. But I think chaos is not always bad if it leads to really new formulation. So I'll just say, we are going to hear from Bill McKibben and from the climate to this time, and that the AAR invited these people to come is a sign that AAR has not succumbed purely to disciplinarity. I really am delighted and I just wish to express my strongest appreciation to the leaders of AAR that they do recognize it's important to know what's going on in the world right now. There's some kind of a context for all of the many sections. Now, let's suppose, I mean, fantasize, just imagine, that we decided that everyone who had responsibility in relationship to one of the meetings at this event next year thought that it should try to make what it was doing relevant to the response to the fundamental questions. That would be the most immediate effect. And you could imagine the topics next year would be rather different, and the way they would be approached would be rather different. Now, after one had done that for a few years, you might decide just to organize everything in a different kind of section rather than organize by disciplines. I'm very glad to say once again, and I just want to point out the resistances that already are present. I think that's something to do with the fact that the field of religion is inherently resistant to the disciplinization, which has been forced upon it by the academic mindset. Okay, the AAR and the SBL separated. But somehow people did recognize there was a loss involved. That for the people who come to AAR, especially the Christians, not to be involved with the Bible in any way, just because you could identify a discipline that didn't say anything about the Bible, and not even have the chance to interact with one's colleagues in biblical fields, that didn't feel right. So that we got back together. I think that's also a great achievement in the direction that I think we want to go. I want first to celebrate the fact that in spite of the fact that most of you, in order to get a promotion or in order just to survive in academia, have to be very clear about what your job is and how it's has its boundaries and is different from what other people do, and you're supposed to take whatever data arises within your field as primary, and its relationship to what happens in the world might appear at the fringes, but is not what you're about. In spite of all that, I do think there's an inner resistance to this way of shaping the activity of the mind. Overall, it seems to me that the great research, value-free universities have taken over much of the greatest talent of our time and prevented it from dealing with the issues of the world. I don't treat this as just a minor little problem. I think it's catastrophic. So, if the resistance that came out of your interest in religion, religio, binding everything together, could have an effect, that would be wonderful. But of course, the field of religion entered into the university very anxious about being acceptable by university standards. So people are driven, perhaps, in this field to prove themselves more than they would be if they were in mathematics or economics or something, which then makes it doubly hard to be a witness or to testify to your own deepest convictions. So I hope you don't understand this as a criticism of individuals. It is for me a criticism of the system. I felt very much the same way when feminists got a foothold in the university. And I agreed with Mary Daly strongly when she said she was not particularly pleased with the results. She said, feminism committed methodicide. That is, it redefined itself as an academic discipline, value-free, just studying one set of phenomena alongside of others, which has nothing whatsoever to do with feminism. When you objectify feminism, study it as a scholar, you're not being a feminist. You have surrendered to, if you like to call it masculine. I mean, I think masculine can be overstated. I mean, males don't always do this. Nevertheless, it is males who have created it. I'm not questioning that. So I would love to have rebellion within the ranks. And I think one way to start the rebellion is to read the book written by an academic leader, which is entitled, Save the World on Your Own Time, meaning you ain't hired by the university to do anything that has any relevance to benefiting the world. And you're not. You are hired to advance study of a very narrow range of topics without any evaluation of whether they make any difference. That's what you're hired for. And therefore, you have a certain responsibility to do what you're being paid to do. But somehow we have to distinguish between the way in which our economic, economized system tells us what to do and our own individual human conviction that's the wrong thing to do. Now, how do you live that way? Ain't easy. But it's still, I think, the challenge that faces us. Well, let me say just a word about why I consider myself a theologian, since first of all, theology is not an academic discipline. It's not allowed to be. Of course, you can have an academic study of theology, just like you can have an academic study of feminism, but that's not feminism, and that's not theology. From my point of view, the study of what other people have said is very different from being one of the people who is saying things. And to be a theologian is saying it. I was at Chicago at a time before the disciplinization of the university was complete. And the chancellor of Chicago and its president at that time was Ernest Cadman Caldwell, who I followed to Emory and then to Claremont. But they were trying to retain a university in which intellectual activity was prized rather than scholarship. And I benefited from that. I studied with philosophers, not students of philosophy. So they were not scholars about philosophy, they were doing philosophy. And sit in the classroom, listen to Carnap one day and Hartshorne the next and McKeon the next. These were creative thinkers. Anyway, I'm just saying there is another way to be a university. The academic discipline way of did not exist before the early 19th century, and it did not conquer the university world until well into the 20th century. So we shouldn't take what is as being, there is the, you know, what is loves to say there is no alternative. If there is no alternative, well, there is no alternative to death, I realize that. But there are ways of postponing it a little while. And I think they should be explored, even in universities. I mean, why should universities ignore the desperate issues that face humanity? There's something profoundly, profoundly wrong. Okay, well, so theology cannot be an academic discipline. Nevertheless, in order to conform to this new world, in the past 200 years, because theology prior to that wouldn't be this way at all, theologians had to say what particular topics they were going to discuss. Now, if you asked Augustine, which particular topics are you going to write about? He said, why? Why should I select particular topics? I'm a theologian. Do I avoid being a philosopher? Well, of course not. Do I avoid dealing with the history of the world? Of course not. Would Thomas say, I can't mention anything about economics because I'm a theologian? Well, I'm very conservative. I just think that the way people used to do theology is the right way to do theology. So I say, well, how do I articulate that? Okay, I say, I think Christian theology is intentionally Christian reflection about any important issue. So if I'm talking about what China should do about agriculture, whether it should industrialize agriculture the way the United States has done, or whether it should pour its energies into building up healthy local communities, which means retaining the peasant villages rather than bulldozing them down, I'm looking at that in terms of Christianity. Now, I find that if you look at it in terms of Confucian values, you'll come out at the same place I come out when I look at it as a Christian. And it'd be a great deal harder to convert a billion people to Christianity than to convert the same billion people to Confucianism. Well, I'm enough of a pragmatist, I say, let's by all means convert them to Confucianism. And the wonderful thing is, in China, that after having sought to suppress Confucianism since about 1919, that's a long time, nearly 100 years, the leading figures of the government of China have now come out in favor of Confucianism. I consider that, I'm not saying that we processed folk had anything to do with it, but I think we helped. Now, this is another way of getting at the question of what is it I'm favoring and what is it I don't like, because I think we all know that our religious traditions, our religious communities, have often been obstacles to dealing with the right, with dealing with the serious issues of our time. And when other people just attack religion wholesale, and they mean all the institutions and all the communities that in common parlance are spoken of as religion, and say, we've got to get rid of all that, that's all an obstacle. Well, to defend it all would be nonsense. If we Christians try to defend everything that's been done in the name of Christianity, we'd make utter fools of ourselves. Even today, if we defend everything that's being done in the name of Christianity. So clearly, that's not what we want. On the other hand, you see what happens when you get rid of all of these ancient traditions. I call them the axial ways. I mean, Karl Jaspers, you know, taught us to do that. Why they call them rational religion? And it meant virtually the same thing. I don't think he had the other language available to him when he wrote his book on religion in the making. when we throw away all those, it turns out we have no significant source for values. I mean, just try it out. So when being secular means you pay no attention to that, then you end up with the value-free university. Now, there's one value that survives. I think I might mention a second one, but one value survives, and that's money. Thoroughgoing secularism is the rule of money. And if you ask what rules the contemporary world, I think you'd probably agree with me, money. Well, Jesus had some rather clear things to say about that. You cannot serve both God and money. Now, the churches try hard to do both. And if they have to give up one, it's likely to be God. Not all, but I just mean, serving money in our society is just conforming to the society. You've got to have some very strong values in order to do anything else. And what I perceived happening in China was that once they had thrown away the little red book of Mao, which is a value-laden book, remarkably congenial to Christian beliefs, they had no values left. And therefore, money was coming to rule China in spite of its other claims. The only way I saw China had any prospect of seriously resisting that was through the recovery of its own traditions, which are value-laden traditions. They have value-free universities, totally alien to what education has been in China all through the years. Education in China was primarily education and values. Of course, to teach values is not just to recite, this is a good, this is good. I mean, there's a whole rich complex that goes to the teaching values. But that was all being erased. Now, it was replaced in China with the values of Marxism. And in my view, Karl Marx was the greatest prophet of the 19th century. And I seek to live in the prophetic tradition. I have actually never called myself a Marxist or a socialist. I simply say Marxism is an expression of the prophetic tradition. Being a follower of Jesus is an expression of the prophetic tradition. We are close cousins. But I'm not getting my ideas from Marx. I'm getting from the same place Marx got his ideals. So for a period of time, China had some values to replace Confucian values, and they came from our Bible. They didn't like to talk about that connection, but I just mean, from my point of view, that's fine. You don't have to know where your values come from. You can think that they were invented in the 19th century. But I think it's good to know history a little bit. And incidentally, one of the consequences of the value-free university is that history no longer plays any significant role in higher education. And to me, that is a terrible loss. And we do need to recognize the Bible is the major source for the historical thinking. No non-biblical culture has ever prized historical thinking the way a biblical culture does. So it's one of my many reasons for being, I think, far more conservative than most people who call themselves conservative. I really want to conserve values that are rooted in the Bible, and I think they have an important. So, when you asked, our primary interest was calling for constructive postmodernism in China. Okay. Constructive postmodernism we defined as employing, incorporating some of the achievements of modernity, but integrating them with the pre-modern value system. That was a way of explaining to our Chinese friends that they had wonderful traditions which were being totally rejected, and in throwing them out, they were entering into a kind of modernity that is totally empty, self-destructive, and so forth. We have also been urging the Marxists in China to pay attention to Marx. So I think that what I regard as the most fundamental biblical values are still semi-alive, officially alive. I mean, the Communist Party still has a picture of Marx up there. Doesn't read him, but that's a minor consideration. We know how Christianity can exist for centuries with nobody reading the New Testament in any serious way. But you can still appeal to it. Okay. So I'm hoping that China will find a way of integrating values from Marx and from Confucius. And if they do, maybe someday they will notice that they could have done that by going to Jesus. But I don't think that's essential. I mean, I don't think it would hurt. And interestingly enough, Christianity is flourishing in China. I suspect as many Chinese are in church Sunday morning as Americans are in church Sunday morning. Now, that may not be saying much, but our whole notion of we as a Christian nation and then those heathen Chinese doesn't have much to do with the reality. So I hope that's a partial answer to some of those things, and some of it is relevant to Philip's questions. So what about religion? Okay. In my book, which did express fresh thinking about religion and secularism and secularization and all of that, which is called the spiritual bankruptcy, I indicated we couldn't. Neither the established religious institutions nor the secular institutions. You can take the modern university as an example of secular institutions. Of course, our business community, we could go on and on, offer much hope of responding well to what we face. I see much more hope in the religious institute, what we call the religious institutions, than I do in the secular institutions. I don't see any hope in the secular institutions as long as they stick to value-free or totally economistic, which are the same thing. I mean, views. I do think that within our religious communities, we have traditions that are highly relevant to the present time. I think this is true of all of the axial traditions. But what has happened to that is sacralization. Okay, I'll bring that word in. We take certain features of these traditions and we put them beyond criticism. We also make them irrelevant to what we actually do. Now, I'm not saying that's the only possible way in which the sacred can work, but it's just the way on which, on a mass scale, it has worked. When you make the Bible sacred, you stop reading it. You put it on the book and worship it. It's totally an unbiblical attitude. The Bible is constantly, the biblical writers are constantly criticizing each other. And Jesus and Paul, keep it up. So why all of a sudden does the book become a sacred book? I think it's an extraordinarily valuable book, but I think sacralizing it is exactly the wrong thing to do. Okay, so that's the kind of, my time's already, okay. 5 minutes, 5 minutes, all right. No, I can quit any time, just say quit. I can also go on indefinitely. Okay. So I think that the religions are all guilty of having distracted attention from the most urgent issues of our time. I think they all have within them potential for directing attention wisely and fruitfully to the most important issues of our time. And that broad statement about the religions is to me more important than saying, what are the distinctive contributions? Once we've said that and really believe it's important that we study them not simply in an academic discipline type of a way, but we study them for wisdom and guidance to deal with the issues. And of course, also we need to go back and deal seriously with the more ancient traditions of tribal people, indigenous people, and gain their wisdom. I don't think this is one or the other kind of thing. I think different things can be learned in these two different ways. But once we do that, then of course it becomes very important to say, well, what is the contribution that the biblical traditions can make? What is the contribution that Buddhism can make? What is the contribution that Taoism can make? What is the contribution that Confucianism? And if you know my work at all, I do not in the least want to say they all make the same contribution. It just ain't so. Once again, it's useful to know something about history. And I've paid the most attention to the contributions that Buddhism can make and that Christianity can make. I mean, but that is not because I don't think the others do. And in China, the renewal of Buddhism can be a very important contribution. I mean, Buddhism has a role in classical Chinese thinking. But of course, Confucianism and Taoism go even more deeply into the soul of China, and I haven't ever done a serious study of them. So my celebration of recovering that is not based on scholarly knowledge of what I'm saying. And I do know enough to know, well, I think it would be difficult to get contemporary women to enthusiastically embrace all of the Confucian teaching. That might have certain tensions. And that's why Marxism can also play a very important role. Marxist China did very well on the gender issue, better than the West has done, I think, in general. So there are values from Marxism, there are values from Confucianism, there are values from Taoism, and if they are lifted up and become, if they could become part of the educational system of China again, as of now, the whole educational system is devoted to the worship of money. In China. They got it from us, but they're doing an even better job. And you can't build an ecological civilization on that kind of educational system. The more immediate thing was you can't build an ecological situation if you destroy what communities are left in China. And the only communities you can build on are the rural communities. A city of 30 million people is not a community. And if that's the only China, that would be. Anyway, I think you'll, in part, explain, I hope, indicates why I have written harshly about the sacred, but also God. Why oppose the sacralization of God? Well, perhaps thinking of God as sacred might lead to worship, but it certainly means that there is no critical thinking about what we mean by God. And I think when we've had such bad ideas about God for so long, it's very important to say, come on now, we can think just as rigorously and tough-mindedly and practically about God as about any other topic. It needs it as much, maybe more than any other topic. And I think we will not, you see, I really believe that belief in God is the only basis of creating communities that do not worship themselves. when Christendom was destroyed, and there were plenty of evils about Christendom. I'm not holding up the Middle Ages as being the ideal organization of human life. But immediately, nationalism came back. And we have suffered from nationalism for the past few centuries. The only appeal against nationalism is that there is an object of devotion that is beyond the nation, or the whatever the grouping may be. A nation is not the only possible organization. And the only time that there has been a serious alternative to national and imperial rule was when there was another power. It was the church. And the church could even hold itself as somehow the nations were accountable to it because it represented God. Now, that then becomes the idolatry of the church. You understand? And the idolatry of the church is just as bad as the idolatry of the nation, but the nation doesn't point beyond itself. And until the church has totally degraded itself, it points beyond itself and says, both church and state should be serving something beyond itself, and that beyond, in principle, puts an end to the we-they distinction. I have to always say in principle because, of course, the church very quickly says we Christians and those unbelievers. And that is to reintroduce in just as vicious a way as any other we-they distinction does. But if you really believe in one God, you got something to work against that with. And so I do take that as a very important part of our need. Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Excellent.
I think we're ready for a few questions. I want to ask you to be concise in your question. I wanted to ask you to be concise in your question, and we're going to ask John to be concise in his answer. Come on. So, questions. Right back here.
Dr. Cobb, when you talk about having a reference beyond the nation or the tribe or the group, yes, or whatever, in this current time, with the crisis that we face, could the earth,
yes,
or Gaia, yeah, be a referent that can serve that purpose?
Yeah.
I have myself written about earthism as a possible next step in terms of where we are. I think that the earth can be. Now, of course, we know already when we talk about the earth that it is simply one small part of the whole. And to treat the earth as if it were the whole is intellectually not intelligible. That bothers me a little bit. But just as I'm very happy to support the renewal of Confucianism in China, I will get any support I can to Gaia, because it will function to accomplish some of the things that can be accomplished if we really seriously believe in God. Yes.
Thank you. In the back?
This is a big question that no one sort of brought up, but there's plenty of new neuroscience research on how we learn to think and our moral formation happening definitively in our very early years,
yes,
as input on how we orient to the world. And I've never called myself a process theologian because I believe that I've learned this non-essential sort of way of being from the time I was born till I
I'm very fortunate in my aging process, but my ears are still not as good as they once were, and I'm not sure I got it all. But I think it's very important for all of us to understand why we think the way we do. And so in my book, I talk about how I was shaped as a child and find it quite surprising. I still think the way I thought when I was a child. So I think I'm fully wanting to agree with that part of it. And but of course, no one supposes that the rest of your life has nothing to do with the way you think. It just means you do recognize the very deep levels. And for example, I think I'm very fortunate that the problem of what they call basic trust is not a problem for me. And I'm very grateful to my parents for that. I mean, that's not something that everybody can share. And it makes a huge difference. And if you're a good process theologian, then you are going to be recognizing that people get shaped differently from a very, very early stage. And that never come out exactly at the same place, if that's the case. You mentioned neuroscience. It is one of my great hopes, because the neuroscientists keep discovering that the metaphysics that governs their assignment keeps them from reporting their evidence. And of course, it's not the first field in which that's happened, but it's a very prestigious field. And I think it's going to help in undermining the dominance of scientism in our society. A long time ago, we worked with, oh my goodness, now I can't. I blame it on aging, but whatever, anyway. A neuroscientist who did the split brain work, he was most famous for that, and he got a Nobel Prize for it, and so forth and so on. And his evidence showed that what he called consciousness, we persuaded him to call it conscious experience, since we don't believe in consciousness, played a role in what happened in the brain. Long time ago, decades ago. Well, he was a physiological psychologist, today we call it neuroscience. And he published on that, and he thought it was an extremely important thing. Well, they didn't take his prize away from him, but that particular understanding, which came to him out of the empirical experiments, was just ignored completely, and the discipline went on its way unscathed by evidence. I think if we could really persuade scientists to pay attention to evidence, we could transform the world very quickly.
Thanks. Other questions? Back here? Black here? Yes.
If we're looking at a kind of going beyond interdisciplinarity to anti-disciplinarity, but the American Academy right now has its own issues with interdisciplinarity in itself, what are the steps we can take right now to start creating that change in the way we look at academia?
As I say, I think there is more interdisciplinary stuff being done in the AAR than in most places, and I would just encourage that. And I think very often two groups meet together and they have a topic that breaks out, goes beyond the boundaries of each. So let me say, what's already happening helps. But what could happen next year? Okay, I'll try to be realistic before I was making a sweeping utopian notion. But if some of you decided that, okay, we did climate change last year, what should we do next year? Does it work? What we're doing this year should carry over and shape what we do next year. And then say, figure out maybe four or five projects that people with religious concern. I mean, the issue of religion and climate change is being written up in books these days, so it wouldn't be too hard. And say, in the AAR, we really should take on this question of how religion is, what is now called religion, is related to climate change, and say, how should it be related? What can we do to move it in that direction? And if next year in the program there were four or five groups, all of which would have to draw on people from more than one field, who really directed themselves seriously to that question. What can we be doing? How can we as scholars contribute to that topic? I would say that would be a wonderful major step, significant step, and I don't think it's impossible. I think if you have a leadership, I mean, years ago the leadership would have not wanted it. I don't think that's true today. I was involved in interreligious dialogue, and we proposed that interreligious dialogue might go on at the AAR. No, that's not academic. No, so I mean, I know there was an opposition to doing something that was not disciplinary. And but now I just don't believe the people who have organized this AAR meeting would say, oh, that would be a bad thing for you to actually seriously deal with the questions we are raising this year. Do it.
Roger Sperry.
Roger Sperry is the name. Thank you.
Thanks so much, John.
Let's give John a hand. I'm sure many of you will want to ask questions to our panelists, greet John. We'll have plenty of time to do that. Thank you so much for making this a delightful session.